Thank you, Shannon, and thanks to all of you for being here today, both online and in person. This is a huge topic. We could spend days talking about the treatment. Obviously, we can't do that. So I will try to focus on a few things, a few disclosures. I want to give you a little history of the guidelines. So the first guideline for the treatment of NTM was published in 1990. It was revised in 1997, and then again in 2007. And the most recent was 2 years ago, 3 years ago, 2020. And we published it in two different journals because one was an ID journal, the other was a pulmonary journal. And we were trying to get, you know, two different populations of providers, the infectious disease providers, as well as the pulmonary. And then last year we published another document because as I'll show you in a moment, you know, we couldn't cover every mycobacterial infection in one document. So we came back and did this other document, which is not a true guideline, is we call it a consensus statement. But for people who have some other infections besides the most common, we tried to cover those there. And I will not go into those more rare infections. So the guidelines that I just mentioned, you see here on the left, and the right is the consensus. And these are the organisms that we covered in the guidelines. I bolded the two that I'm going to discuss today because these are the most common, Mycobacterium avium complex and Mycobacterium abscessus. But just recognize that the others you see here, we do have some guidelines and or recommendations from this consensus statement. So unlike tuberculosis, which is if we grow tuberculosis in a respiratory specimen, we treat everybody. There's no decision, should I treat or should I not treat? This is what makes NTM much more difficult for clinicians because we now have to figure out who will we treat and whom will we not treat. So we have some diagnostic criteria. One, the person presents with symptoms like cough, fatigue, and weight loss. That should be in a setting that they have a radiographic abnormality that is consistent with NTM. The top panel here is just a slice from a CT scanner showing bronchiectasis, those kind of clusters, looks like clusters of grapes. And then the bottom is what we call fibrocavitary disease. This is when we see cavities in the upper part of the lung. It looks just like TB a lot of the time. But the more common phenotype would be what you see in the top panel. And that's what we call nodular bronchiectatic disease. It's mainly in the setting of bronchiectasis. It turns out they can also have cavities. So you can have a cavity and still have nodular bronchiectatic disease. And then this is an infection, so we need to confirm it. And we do that in the laboratory. The most important criteria for us is if someone grows an NTM two or more times from a sputum. There are other criteria, but we think this is the more important than getting just a single bronchoscopic specimen. It's not as predictive in our view as having multiple positive sputum cultures. So the diagnostic criteria then, if someone grows MAC as an example, they have symptoms, they have a radiograph that looks like one of these, and they have two or more positive cultures, we say they meet diagnostic criteria. So, and we call that disease being caused by the NTM. But that doesn't mean we're going to treat you. We still have to think more about that. So let's just kind of break down this thought process. So we need to consider the patient, the organism that they're growing, and what are the goals of treatment. So let's think about the patient. Here's a CT that has a cavity. So one of the things I'm thinking about in clinic is, does this person have increased susceptibility? Are they immunocompromised? Do they have lung disease, cystic fibrosis, something that might increase their susceptibility? Do they have symptoms? You know, we say that if you don't have symptoms, I can give you symptoms by giving you antibiotics. So we're probably more likely to treat someone who has symptoms than someone who has no symptoms. And then the radiograph, I think, for us clinicians is very, very important because if I see a cavity like this, that black hole there, that is destruction of the lung. I don't need to wait to see if this person's going to progress. They are going to progress. So that would push me to treat. So looking at the patient in terms of their susceptibility, whether they're symptomatic, and do they have evidence of cavitation or progressive disease, very important for us. But there are about 200 different species, so we got to think about the organism too. And they're not all pathogenic. Not all of the 200 species harm us. This is just to give you kind of a pictorial of how we think through this. So if we go from the left, where it says zero on the bottom, all the way to 100, this is kind of taking some of these organisms and plotting them, how often they cause disease. So there are some that we find often in water that are very unlikely to cause disease, and thus this grouping of organisms, many of these you probably have never heard of. But then as we go to the right, we see things that are more pathogenic. So Mycobacterium abscessus in avium, in this study that's actually not a published study, was in the middle. But if you go all the way to the right, these are the ones that were more pathogenic. So if they grew in the person's sputum, they were sick from it. And this is how we have to think about this. So there are organisms that if the lab tells me you have Mycobacterium gordoni, which is a very common water isolate, none of us are going to treat you for that. Even if you grow it three times, we're probably not going to treat you. We're going to do good airway clearance. But if you grew Mycobacterium sulgi, which is all the way to the right, probably going to treat you for that one, because usually it's going to harm you, and we don't want that to happen. And then the goals of therapy. So when someone comes in with TB, the goal of therapy is always cure. I mean, we don't think anything else. We're going to cure that person. Unfortunately, depending on the species of NTM, cure may not be the goal. If it's not the goal, then what are the other goals? Well, one may be just to get your cultures to become negative. After all, that's how we determine how long we're going to treat you. But a higher bacteriologic load is associated with more progression, so we would like to decrease that. Obviously, we'd like to improve your symptoms. And maybe we can prevent progression, even if we can't cure someone. And the ability to cure, again, depends on the organism. So this is an example. So Mycobacterium kinzasii is one of the more common slow growers. We cure almost every single person we treat who has that NTM. If we look at MAC, though, if you look at the published studies, cure rates are 56 to 85%. You know, it's a very big range. And that's based often on just, do you have cavities or not? Mycobacterium abscessus has an even bigger range of cure rates, from 25 around to 80%. And that will depend on which subspecies you have. And we'll talk about that. So my discussion with you in the clinic about what to expect will often depend on which species you have. And it could be anything from cure to, let's just see if we can make you better. So this is where we are. We're trying to balance, you know, the risk and the benefits. And if we don't treat you, maybe you progress. And maybe if I treat you and you didn't need to because you weren't progressing, you're going to potentially have side effects. So for every patient, we have to balance this. And it comes out differently depending on the individual. So busy slide, but this is how we had to think through this. Very difficult decision. Do we start treatment in you, or do we do what's called watchful waiting? The important part is watchful. I can't tell you we're not going to treat you now and then you leave and never come back. You need to buy into this concept that, well, I'm not going to treat you, but we're going to watch you carefully. What does that mean? Repeat imaging periodically, repeat sputum cultures. But these are the recommendation. This is the recommendation in the guideline. In patients who meet the diagnostic criteria, which we talked about, we suggest initiation of treatment rather than watchful waiting, but especially in people who have positive smears, that means they're coughing up a lot of bacilli, or if they have cavitary disease, because that's evidence of lung destruction. And so how do you come up with this? Well, you look at these studies. These are three studies. The results from three studies are from South Korea, different centers. They're pretty big studies. I mean, 500 to 1,000 people, and they watched them. They did watchful waiting for 4 to 6 years. So they didn't initiate treatment, but watched to see who was going to show evidence of progression. And if they did, then they started treatment. So on the left, almost 500 patients who had MAC pulmonary disease, none of them had been treated before, and they met those ATS criteria. So about 63% progressed over that 5 to 6 years, but not all did. About 24% were stable, and about half of those, their cultures became negative without treatment. Now, they may have done airway clearance. We don't know. That's not in the article. We can't figure that out. The next study in the middle, almost exactly the same findings, a little bit higher percentage of people were stable, but half of their patients also spontaneously converted their cultures to negative. And then one on the right that I was involved in South Korea, almost 1,000 patients. These were patients, mostly had MAC, but there were a few that had abscesses. 55% progressed, 45% stable, about a third spontaneously converted. So my take on this is if you meet the criteria that we reviewed, the ATS criteria, the majority of you will progress in 4 to 6 years, right? That's what these three studies all showed. Now, if these studies had gone 10 years or 15 years, maybe that's a higher number. Maybe that's 70% or 80%. We don't know. But I think these studies gave us some very important information that progression is more likely than not. The issue is, before I leave this, the issue is, are there risk factors, you know, that tell us, yeah, you're more likely to progress? And these studies, in fact, did show that if you had cavitary disease, if you have more extensive disease, if you have high bacterial loads, and if you're particularly sick, symptomatic, and so forth, these are things that we look at clinically to determine whether we think you're at even higher risk than maybe someone else. This is why it's hard as a clinician. You have to weigh each person so individualized. Whereas in TB, for example, we just start 4 drugs and we cure almost everybody. So let's think about treatment then. So we made the decision to treat. It's going to vary. It's going to vary based on which species is isolated from our patients. We do know because you're taking multiple drug regimens and that is required. You heard earlier that we never give one drug to treat a mycobacteria. It will become resistant to that drug and we lose it forever. So we're very careful about having a multi-drug regimen on board. And it's also not only just that there's multiple, but which ones. But because we're giving you multiple drugs, of course, there's a frequency of side effects that is unwanted, of course. Duration's long. We would love to have a shorter duration. And I'll tell you, if we had a shorter duration, I don't know we'd use those criteria anymore. We'd probably treat everybody. If we could treat people in 3 months, we'd treat people. Why? But we have long regimens. So we want to all be convinced. And by all, I mean me and you, that treatment is right for you. And it's right for you at this time. Treatment outcomes are suboptimal. I showed you the outcomes varies by species. Kinzasii, fantastic. Roy, you want to get a smile on my face? Come to me in clinic with Kinzasii, because we're both going to be happy because you're going to get cured. But for most of these that we treat, you may get it again. And we'll go into that. So these are the drugs we use. We're going to hear about some new ones from Dr. Olivier later, which we're very excited about. But this is kind of what we have to work with. If you have an allergy to one or more of those, or your isolate is resistant, this list gets short fast. And we don't have nearly enough drugs right now. Most that we use, most of the species that we treat, we use oral regimens. But for Mycobacterium abscessus, as an example, which we'll talk about in more detail, we have to use intravenous drugs too. And now we have inhaled drugs, and we'll talk about that. So this is just an example that people are presenting in lots of different ways. We think of this as affecting older women primarily, and that's true. But this was a very healthy 35-year-old woman from Florida who had cavitary MAC. Why? She had no lung disease. She had no immune issues, but it happens. And we're seeing younger people come in with MAC. And in her case, the CT showed multiple cavities. So, you know, pretty severe MAC. She was treated and actually underwent removal of her right upper lobe. And this was over a decade ago, and she's been cured ever since. I mean, she's never had it again. But, you know, we have to be thinking more about it as clinicians. If people are presenting a lot of different ways with MAC. So what is MAC? So Mycobacterium avium complex. All of these names are species that are considered MAC. Most laboratories in the United States do not tell your doctors this. It just, the report says Mycobacterium avium complex. But you could have two of these at the same time, or you could start off with Mycobacterium chimera, and then in 6 months, you might be growing avium. But the clinicians don't see this information unless they go to some reference labs like National Jewish in Texas and Mayo to some extent. But all of these are important. And the reason you haven't seen a lot of these or heard about them is they don't cause us to be sick very often. They're still called MAC. I want to know which MAC you have. Do you have intracellular or avium, because they're the most common and I know they can harm you. But some of these others, none, we have never seen a case. But your doc just sees MAC and they're going to treat MAC. But maybe they wouldn't if they knew exactly which species you have. So this is something we need to change. It's a culture we need to change in the US. So the laboratory, again, is very important. This is, as I said, this is what they usually see. It'll say what the species is. It's called the identification. It'll just say M-avium complex. It won't say intracellulary or avium or chimera or yonganets and some of the others. And the susceptibility report often is a listing of drugs. And it just says R, meaning resistant, S, meaning susceptible, I, meaning intermediate. But what we've learned in this field is this is not the whole story, because when rifampin is resistant, we see people respond, and when it's susceptible, maybe they don't. Same with ethambutol. So resistance to those drugs is not interpretable. It's actually recommended it not be done. In fact, what's recommended, it's only to be done the least you should do is amikacin and clarithromycin. And then linezolid, moxifloxacin, these are ones that the lab can do. But it's also important that when we identify it, that we tell you which species it is, and that a very few labs in the US will tell you how much you grow. Those of you who are at National Jewish know your colony counts. You keep track of your colony counts. You know, is it 10, is it 100, is it 300? Because the higher the colony count, the higher the bacterial load, and the more likely people are going to progress. So we would love to see in the US that this would be shifted and all laboratories would be able to provide this level of information. So these are now the recommended regimens for the treatment of MAC. Is very straightforward in this regard. Some of you, I know you're going, well, I got 3 times a week, but my friend had 5 or 7 days a week therapy. Why was it different? Well, it's based on the phenotype. Remember that nodular bronchiectatic disease versus the cavitary disease. So for the nodular bronchiectatic, the more common, we recommend 3 drugs, one of which should be azithromycin, the other is rifampin and ethambutol. And because there's no cavitation in this setting, you can be treated 3 days a week. And that is the recommendation in the guidelines. Now, your doctor may say, I've never done that. I want to give it to you daily. That's okay. That's not wrong. But they are able to choose 3 times a week, as are you. But if you have cavitary, things are different, because cavitary disease is more difficult to treat. So we recommend a 4th drug, and that is usually intravenous amikacin. Is used to treat other types of infection, but is quite active against MAC. It's actually one of the more active drugs. And this is given usually for 2 to 3 months, while you're on the other 3 drugs. And here in cavitary disease, we do not recommend 3 times a week therapy. We recommend daily therapy. So that is really based on, unfortunately, a paucity of evidence. We don't have great data on this. So I would say a lot of this is based on clinical expert opinion. So let's kind of think through this. So you grow MAC. The first thing that I'm looking at is that lab report. is your max susceptible to the macrolide? So that's clarithromycin is what we test in the laboratory, but azithromycin is what we treat you with. If it is susceptible, most of the time it is, then I have another question. Do you have cavities on your x-ray or do you have cavities on your CAT scan? If you don't, I can give you the 3 times a week. If you do, we're going to go with daily therapy. And then we're going to consider the IV amikacin. Now, if you've been treated before, it's possible that your isolate is resistant to the macrolides. So that means we go to the other side of this figure. So it is not macrolide susceptible. So we're not going to treat you with a macrolide. It doesn't help. And we're going to give you rifampin and ethambutol, but now we have to find one or two other drugs. The list is not very long. And these are the type of drugs. In terms of other drugs, there's some new drugs we'll hear about, omatocycline and tadalafil or things we might try to get, but they're very difficult to get because of their cost. So we do not want to create macrolide resistant MAC. It is very difficult to treat. And this is to make that point. So looking at the literature, these are examples of culture conversion rates, recurrence rates, and reinfection in people who have been treated for MAC. If you have macrolide susceptible, which is what we always hope you have, and there's no cavities, culture conversion somewhere in the 70 to 80% range. Cavitary disease, there's at least one report that was only 50% conversion, but somewhere between 50 and 80%. Okay, now you're cured. But if we continue to follow you, which we would, and get sputum, anywhere from 25 to almost 50% of people, they recur. So that means they have a new positive culture. They were negative for at least a year, and then they grow it again. So this is very common. And then if you do some molecular testing of that organism, what you'll find is that about 50 to 75% of the time, it's different than the one you started with. So the term for that is reinfection. So why does that happen? Well, we don't cure your bronchiectasis. We don't cure your lung disease, and you go back to the same environment. So it shouldn't really be surprising that people get it again. And I think this is one of the most important research questions is where are people getting it? Exactly. We know from work from Dr. Honda, Dr. Falkingham, it's in the soil, it's in volcanic ash, it's everywhere. But where did you get it? Was it your garden? Was it your tap water? Was it your hot tub, your swimming pool? These are things that we just don't have enough clarity on. Because if we had a better idea of that, maybe we could come up with interventions so we could get rid of this reinfection. And then the recurrences would go down and we would cure more people. So we introduced this new term in the 2020 guidelines called treatment refractory disease. And this is the recommendation. This is really one of the more novel recommendations from the new guidelines. And patients with MAC pulmonary disease who have failed therapy after at least 6 months of guideline-based therapy. So you take those three drugs, the azithromycin, rifampin, and ethambutol, but 6 months later, the cultures are still positive. That is a treatment refractory condition. And here we strongly recommended addition of amikacin liposome inhaled suspension. We call it ALIS. Based on 2 randomized trials. And in medicine, those are the strongest evidence we have. This particular trial was called the CONVERT study. It was a randomized controlled trial of people who had treatment refractory disease based on that definition. And what we see here, if I can get this to work, this is each of these bars is the percent of people whose cultures are becoming negative. Remember, they got into the trial because they were still positive. The dark bars are those who received ALIS. The lighter are those who received just the standard therapy. You can see by 1 month that 15%, almost twice as many people were converting. And as we get out to 4 months, it was 30 versus 9. So we learned a very important lesson here. If someone comes in and they're still culture positive and we just keep doing the same thing, only 9% are going to convert. So we would never do that to you. We have to do something else. And the thing that we have the most evidence for is to begin this inhaled liposomal amikacin, or ALIS. So that added a third treatment category, which we call the refractory group. Here we recommend four or more. So you get the azithromycin, rifampin, and thambutol, but now we're gonna be adding the ALIS to your regimen. In refractory disease, if someone's on three times a week, we put them on daily. So we generally don't treat refractory disease with intermittent therapy, but with daily therapy, and we add that. Now, if you have cavitary disease and you haven't been treated with IV amikacin, we may do that first for a couple of months and then transition to the inhaled amikacin. So summary for MAC, this is a disease that it's importantly that is treated with a macrolide-based regimen like azithromycin. We would consider an aminoglycoside like amikacin for cavitary disease. And also when there's macrolide-resistant disease, we treat for at least 12 months of beyond the point of culture conversion. And the point here is that you need to be giving sputum like every month so that we can figure out when you convert. If you only give them every 6 months, you're going to get 6 months more treatment than you would have gotten, right? Because if you convert at month three, we add 12 months, and that's a 15-month regimen. But if I don't know that you didn't convert for 6 months, and that could end up being, you know, an 18-month regimen. So we want to get monthly to every 2 month specimens. We expect to cure macrolide susceptible MAC in 70 to 80% of people. But if we cannot do that and they're refractory, we're going to add ALIS and recurrence is common. So let's switch to abscessus. So this is one of my patients, a 68-year-old woman with chronic cough and fatigue. She has multiple cavitaries, you know, so surgery was kind of out of the question here, something we consider probably more frequently in people who have abscessus than MAC. But when it's like this with multiple cavities, it really was not an option. So Mycobacterium abscessus, the name has been changing. It's a very confusing organism. So many clinicians have been seriously unable to keep up with kind of the naming changes. It was actually discovered a long time ago, 1953, in the knee of this person, and some subcutaneous abscesses, hence the name. But it wasn't named until 1992, and that's when it was called abscessus. In 2006, based on a genomic study, they said, no, it's actually three different species. And that's when these names of abscessus, maciliens, and bledii came about. They retracted the name maciliens in 2011. They broke a rule, a naming violation. And then for a while in the US, we were just working with two, what were called subspecies. We did a study with Korean colleagues in 2013 and said, you know, we need to rename these things. It's really three subspecies. And that was confirmed by another group in 2016. So that's the current convention. So the physician getting their lab report should be told which subspecies it is. Guess what? That's not what happens. They're just told it's abscessus complex or abscessus group, and they often don't know which, but I'm going to point out the importance of this. The reason abscessus is difficult to treat, more difficult to treat than MAC, is just very resistant to so many different antibiotics. We just have a very small number available. But the most important resistance is macrolide resistance, just like it is with MAC. We don't want to have macrolide resistance. The difference between MAC and abscessus is there's two ways you can get macrolide resistance. One is there's a mutation occurs in what's called the RRL gene. And when that happens, it's resistant. We're not going to use it. It's not going to do anything. But there's another mechanism in abscessus, and this doesn't exist with MAC, and it's called inducible resistance. And it's based on another gene called ERM41. And what happens in this setting is that the organism, when you first test it, will show that it's susceptible. But if you keep the macrolide in the media and then you come back 14 days later, it'll be fully resistant. So it's inducing the resistance through this gene. So the way this works, so if we look at the top left, so Mycobacterium abscessus, subspecies abscessus, has this ERM gene. What that means is it's working. And that means you will have inducible resistance develop. And that means macrolide doesn't work and we're not going to give it to you. Anywhere from 10 to 20% of isolates has a mutation in that ERM gene. It's called a C28 mutation. That means that it makes it non-functional. Yippee, because when it's not functional, that means you will not have inducible resistance and we can use the macrolide. And that increases the chance of cure going from in the 20s up to 80. Now, the subspecies Mycelliensis, that's the good abscessus. This is why I want to know, does my patient have abscessus abscessus or abscessus Mycelliensis? It has the gene, but a piece is missing, so it doesn't work. Macrolides work. We're going to treat the person with the macrolide. And then Bledii, which is not very common, it has the gene almost always, this functional, so we can't. So Mycelliensis, we can use a macrolide, and 10 to 20% of abscessus. So we really need to know this as a clinician. Can I use this in my patients? So this is what most people see from their lab. It's called M. coloni abscessus group. Coloni is a different species and is easier to treat. The clinician has to know, is it coloni or is it abscessus? And they often are not told that. And then I just showed you, even once we find that it's abscessus, there are three subspecies, and I need to know that. The drug susceptibility reports are usually kind of uninterpretable. It's the same thing, RIS, but they don't correlate very well with how the patient does. So you may come to me with abscessus. You see your report and it says imipenem resistant. And what's the first drug I tell you I'm going to treat you with? Imipenem, because I don't look at the resistance pattern, because it doesn't correlate with how you do. And this is a confusing part of the field. What we'd like is just like with MAC, we get some idea of the bacterial load. We tell you which species it is, and we tell you in the setting of abscessus which subspecies it is. And then they have to know the ERM gene status. Does your isolate, will the macrolide work or not? And very much like MAC, the two drugs we're most interested in are amikacin and clarithromycin. But the other drugs, we don't really have good correlation with how you do. And we just know they work when we give them to patients. So this is, you can already see, more complicated than MAC. So we start with abscessus, and then we look at that functionality of that ERM gene. If it is functional, then we're probably not going to use the macrolide. Sometimes, as you heard from Dr. Goldstein, we'll use it if you have Pseudomonas, and sometimes that's the reason, but it's not going to kill the abscessus. And then we got to find a couple other drugs. And this is, you know, we don't have a lot to work with. And we have very few active oral drugs. Duration of therapy is the same, but it's much harder to get to that point of culture conversion if you have abscessus. Because these are the outcomes that we expect. Sputum conversion. These are small studies, but they were very consistent in what they found. And these labs did tell the physician or the provider, did their patient have abscessus abscessus or abscessus Mycelliensis? So look at the difference. If you have abscessus, 25% to 42% culture conversion. If you have Mycelliensis, you know, 82 to 96%, it is a huge difference. And the lab has to tell us this information. And we have to tell you the truth, what we might expect depending on your organism as far as outcomes. So M. abscessus, why is it bad? It's just very resistant. It's just resistant to so many antibiotics. The treatment requires a combination of oral, inhaled, IV therapy. Treatment outcomes are good when you have ERM41 gene. That means that it's not if it's not working. Most recurrences, just like with MAC, are reinfection. So you get cured, you go out, you come back. It turns out it's usually reinfection. And surgery is something we're much more likely to consider in this setting, because if we don't have good antibiotics, we do surgery. And we showed in a report from here, and there's others as well, that people with abscessus who had surgical resection in addition to antibiotic therapy had higher cure rates. So it is something to consider. So with that, I'll stop and see if we have questions.
Most of the studies seem to be aged. Is there new studies going on?
You will be hearing about those from Dr. Olivier. Yeah. Yeah. So what you saw were what we had available to make recommendations in the guideline. Okay. That's kind of the evidence that we had available, which is not very good, as you saw.
My question was,
Oh, sorry. The question was, a lot of the studies look older, and are there new studies? And so Dr. Olivier will be going over what's coming. But I was saying that those are the studies that were available for us to make the recommendations and write those guidelines. And you saw what we had to work with. There's not a lot of evidence out there. We do need more. Yes, in the back.
I think you mentioned that MAI is one of the most common
of the species. But then on the slide, on the left-hand side, there's less. Yeah. So other studies that have looked at... Thank you. The point was that I said that MAI, first of all, that's what I was, MAC, I'm going to use the term MAC as opposed to MAI. So Mycobacterium avium complex is one of the organisms that can definitely cause progressive lung disease, and so we treat that. But on that pathogenicity scale, it was kind of more in the middle. It turns out that about 50% of people who grow MAC never grow it again. So that's where that 50% comes from, why it's in the middle. So just growing it one time, we know that half the people are not going to grow it again. But if you do grow it again, now you meet the disease criteria that we reviewed. And that is possible that it will lead to progressive disease. So no, MAC is definitely a pathogenic organism, but it's not as pathogenic as Solgi, probably Xenopi, Kansasii, but it is definitely one to worry. And the reason I'm making the distinction about MAI versus MAC, MAI was the term we used years ago when AIDS was, we saw a lot of disseminated disease, and there were only two species, avium and intracellulary. But now we have 10 plus, and so it's truly a complex, and that's why MAVM complex, I think, is a better term. I wish I could get doctors to listen to me. They don't, they still use MAI.
That impact patients so drastically given their comorbidities. How would often people use of antibiotic be affected in their patient cases? If a patient because of comorbidities cannot hold on oral antibiotics, would inhaled antibiotics be consistent?
So the question is, you know, these antibiotics are used off-label and for a long time, right, for long durations, and how do they impact us? And would inhaled antibiotics be another way to do it? So to your point, there's only one FDA-approved drug for the treatment of MAC, and that's ALIS, which we talked about, the inhaled liposomal amikacin compound. Everything else is off-label. Definitely everything is off-label for abscesses, but that's all we have. We have to treat patients with what we have, and it's based on what the activity looks like in the laboratory, what it's looked like in clinical cohorts, and in the rare trials that we have. Most of the side effects that we see are not permanent side effects. They stop, you know, when we stop the therapy. And yes, side effects are frequent, and you're going to be hearing about that next. So it might be also a question to consider when we talk about the side effects of medicine. But most people tolerate the regimen.
If I may just
draw
on
this,
in Europe, they manufacture the generic drugs for the
So the comment was that in Europe they have inhaled amikacin. It's not a liposomal amikacin. It's cheaper, and but we have that here in the U.S. too, and before we had the liposomal, that's what we did for 30 years. We gave that kind of amikacin. That's just the IV form of amikacin, which we dilute in saline. There's not a single study on earth that has looked at the efficacy. So we don't know if it works. Dr. Olivier published regarding the side effects, and it had a lot of side effects also. So there's no evidence, but in with the liposomal compound, we have two randomized control studies, you know, so we had evidence. And until we get evidence, we're gonna use the liposomal first. But if they don't tolerate it, we will try what you're talking about. We will go back to what we used to do and give them the IV form through inhalation. But we need some evidence, you know, and we just don't have it yet. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Dave, I'll pull this slide here. He's right there. Great. Thank you, Chuck.
Yeah.